Great. If everyone can make their way back to their seats, we're going to try to get started for the next panel, and I'm going to turn it over to the moderator of that panel, Ben Batros. I have a very loud voice, so I know it's not a problem with my voice not being loud enough and calling the attention of everyone, but we are about to start. If you could quiet down, that would be great. I'm about to turn it over to Ben Batros, who's going to moderate this panel. I just wanted to say, because I'm sure people are getting antsy and hungry, there will be lunch immediately following this panel. I knew if I spoke about food, people would start paying some attention. There will be lunch following this panel immediately afterwards, and it will be served out in the atrium, and we'll ask people to get their lunch quickly and come back in, because we are very privileged to have as our lunchtime keynote speaker today, Gabriel Zucman, the author of The Hidden Wealth of Nations, an economist from Berkeley Law School, Berkeley and the university. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to Ben. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Nikki. I think if there's one thing that's clear from the panels that have come before us, it's that there's an awful lot of issues and questions packed into the relationship between tax and human rights. We thought we'd try to squeeze one more of those issues in before lunch, and the good news is that this panel is going to focus on just one issue and just one actor, transparency and the role of governments. Of course, the bad news is it is never quite that simple. Transparency itself is a huge issue. Are we talking transparency between governments for the purposes of enforcement, transparency towards the public for the purpose of advocating better policies or better enforcement? Are we talking about transparency for the purpose of achieving human rights, or transparency as a human right in itself? Now, I would like to think that the breadth and importance of this issue is reflected in the size of this panel. Or maybe we just figured that we'd finally got the timing down pat on four-person panels and figured we'd press our luck. The good news is that I know that the importance of this panel is reflected in the quality of the presenters, so I'll get to them right now. Thanks, Miranda.
Thank you. I was fortunate to be at NYU during April this year and had a chance to discuss with Nikki and Philip their plans for this conference. It's very exciting. I basically invited myself. I didn't want to miss it. So I'm most grateful for the opportunity, and congratulations. A couple of brief comments. For a start, I'd just like to, on tax lawyers, I'd like to reassure you all that things were not better in the old days in Australia. Things were much worse. So this sort of thing about the nostalgic good of the old days, you know, anything went, right? You just had to go over to the Cook Islands, no big deal. But then, you know, we have an anti-avoidance rule. So there is a moderating fact there. And look, the other interesting anecdote, I think, the same day that the European Commission decision came down on Apple in Ireland, there was news in Myanmar of the lifting of US sanctions as a part of sort of Myanmar's sort of final kind of engagement back into the global community. And the main leading story there was that we want our Apple, right? So it's not that they wanted Apple to locate in Myanmar, they wanted these. Right? They wanted the iPhone. And so I think the complexity of tax and development, Myanmar is one of the poorest countries in the region, the lowest tax to GDP ratio, those complexities that sort of exist, they want that company because they want the stuff, like the rest of us. So this panel is about transparency. Who could be against transparency? Concept has attracted unprecedented attention in financial and tax debates, I would say in the last three decades. Of course, it has a much longer history. But I really think the word transparency since the early 1990s has been adopted as a kind of a slogan or goal by a whole diversity of institutions and actors, international governments, NGOs, academic commentators, and media at both ends of the political spectrum. So it performs a range of uses and functions. It's been argued as a key element for reforms aimed at ending corruption and abuses of power, disciplining the fiscal activity of government by constraining spending and reducing taxes, strengthening markets, building participatory democracy, protecting human rights, supporting economic development, and increasing tax collection. Transparency can achieve all these things. So it's presented as a neutral procedural norm, but it has normative content. And I think it's important to consider what different constituencies or policy ends transparency is being used for in any particular context. So my paper sort of tries to explore this. Those who've seen it, it's a very early and messy draft, but I sort of try to do a kind of genealogy of this concept of transparency in the last three decades. Just very briefly, I guess, I identify two main patterns, and that's what I'll focus on in this time. So in the 80s and 90s, I think transparency sort of surfaced as this standard that was aimed at disciplining governments. It was actually transparency of governments that was a key focus. Of course, in the NGOs, Transparency International, established in 1993, this very public campaign about corruption, and there is this ongoing strand of work about transparency, money laundering, financial crime. And I think the comment before about the interaction of that with automatic tax data sharing is an interesting one. In another strand, there was a substantial amount of work done in the 90s on codes and practices of fiscal transparency by the IMF, the OECD, and other organizations about what governments should be doing about fiscal transparency or of their budgets. The main purpose of that work, some research I've done previously, was the transparency of governments to the market. It was about disciplining governments for the market. That was the main audience for that sort of budget transparency. And I suggest that we see the current emphasis on fiscal austerity since the global financial crisis and this sort of pervasive fear in rich countries of the future unsustainable cost of government is actually one of the one of its antecedents or causes is actually this transparency norm. This idea that somehow we need to account for everything and that we can account for the future cost of government. And it looks like a good idea to do generational accounting and plan for the long term, but it's actually quite deceptive and misleading to assume that we know what's going to happen in the future or that numbers can represent that. The latest example of that is what's called the investment approach. The Australian government has just released a report costing the social welfare state for the whole population over its life course and come up with this horrifying number of $4.8 trillion. So fine, what are we going to do with that number? That construction of that number, which looks like transparency of accounting to the people, already carries within it embedded ideological norms about the role of government. So citizens as well, though, in the 90s, sort of looked at this idea of transparency obligations on government and saw the value of budget transparency for a different audience. And when Winnie said yesterday that on the spending side, a lot of work has been done, she's right. There actually has been quite a lot of work done about how to analyze budgets and spending from a gender perspective, from other perspectives, to try to make it more participatory, more democratic, more effective in delivering substantive human rights. So we don't want to let go of that, that need for accountability, but we want to hold governments to account because, you know, we want to make sure that they actually do the job. So if we turn the other direction, and now in the last decade, we have this increasing focus on transparency of taxpayers, that's not just a semantic difference. That actually carries with it sort of some interesting implications, I guess. We shouldn't forget, we talk about secrecy jurisdictions, but there is a history of secrecy for all countries and all taxpayers, with very few exceptions across the board. This is a feature of the construction of effective tax states, is this idea of secrecy. So I'm not saying, you know, secrecy is a dirty word, right? But I think that it's important to understand how embedded that is in the design of tax systems. So in the 90s, when work proceeded on budget transparency, the OECD also developed its first harmful tax competition report and project, and as tax scholars in this room know, and probably most of the human rights people too, that failed, really, for various reasons, at sort of shutting down secrecy or ending secrecy. Since 2000, we have this sort of growing action, and certainly the NGOs have played a major role in bringing this to the table publicly. Yeah, Action Aid's work, Tax Justice, the work about illicit financial flows. Nonetheless, it's not until the post-global financial crisis, you know, and the G20 leadership that we saw any serious action. on any of this. And the first serious action is about transparency of taxpayers to governments and between governments for the first time. So governments have this long history in tax of being secret from each other, you know, sovereignty not helping each other, and also taxpayers not being unable to get all the information they need about the taxpayers themselves. You know, it's only 1 year since we potentially see automatic information exchange and country-by-country reporting. So these are really extremely recent shifts. And I guess one of the questions is, what is the function of this new kind of transparency? What are we expecting governments to do with the information? And another issue I'd like to raise there is the issue of public reporting. So today, the public reporting of taxes and financial information of corporates and individuals is on the agenda. Australia has been leading the way. We actually passed a law that requires the Commissioner of Tax to report on large corporate tax paid gross income, taxable income. We had our first report last December for large companies. You know, that report showed that one third of Australian companies paid no tax in 2014. Now, are they all massive tax avoiders? Well, the tax lawyers in the room know that it's not that simple. Although base erosion and profit shifting, debt loading is a part of that story, it doesn't drive that story. There's all sorts of core features of the corporate tax, loss carry forward, the exemption for foreign business income in Australia. Commodity prices fell in 2014, that affects the tax take. So there's a question of the function of that public disclosure of corporate taxes. I think that the public, so I want to sort of think very briefly about these different aspects. The public disclosure does have a role to play. It doesn't have a direct role to play in helping the revenue raise taxes, because the revenue already has much more information than that available to it. But what it does is it may embarrass companies. We've talked about corporate social responsibility, and I won't go there. It may embarrass companies into paying more. I'm not sure that it will, but it might. I think its function really is that it operates as an indirect check, an accountability mechanism to turn our attention back to government and to ask what government is doing to enforce its tax law. So the function here, again, of the transparency is actually to hold our governments to account. Yeah, that really becomes the function of that public reporting. And I guess the question becomes, what about individuals? Should we be having public disclosure reporting for individuals? And I'm uncomfortable about that. I mean, I wonder if publicity means that privacy of individuals is irrelevant anyway these days for technological reasons. But let's assume it is. So I think that the current sort of bargain that we have between taxpayers and the state still requires that individual privacy. So look, just a couple of comments and I will wrap up. I think that once we inquire into the uses and meaning of transparency, we end up with this challenge that is there for both tax and human rights advocates. So taxation is inherently about the state. It's about funding government. Human rights seems to come from a broader idea that these rights inhere in us or have some universal function. There's a reason why taxation has become the dominant means to fund a successful state. It is the most dignified or reliable or the least coercive mechanism for raising that revenue. But that comes with a fiscal constitution, and that bargain that we've constructed over the last 100 years has been premised on protecting taxpayer information. So if you're going to unpack that bargain, I guess the question becomes, just be careful about what the implications of that might be for the broader fiscal bargain internationally. I guess the final thing is I would say, of course, I support transparency. I'm certainly in favor of empowering governments to access more information. But I worry a little bit about it's too easy for politicians to blame multinationals for failing to pay their fair share, while those same politicians refuse to be responsible for managing their domestic tax bases, and at the same time as blaming multinationals will pursue policies of fiscal austerity that actually harm potentially their own citizens. So we need to be careful about managing this multinational debate. Governments really need to actually, in the end, incorporate multinationals into the tax system globally rather than being in a contested relationship with them. And that's what will strengthen tax systems in the longer term. Thank you.
Thanks very much, and thanks to Philip and Nikki for organizing this wonderful conference. We've heard a lot about whether taxing authorities apply the tax law fairly, whether in the context of international transfer pricing or the treatment of wealthy taxpayers in the United States, tax-exempt organizations. And many have responded to questions about the actions of the taxing authority by calling for greater tax transparency. Actually, this is a great topic to talk about right after Miranda's presentation. One way that people have often said we can achieve greater tax transparency is by increasing public disclosure of tax return information. So this project takes a look at what tax return information should be publicly disclosed as a way to achieve accountability of the taxing authority. And in addressing this question, I consider the role of timing. So taxing authorities often engage in enforcement that occurs ex post, after taxpayers have filed their tax returns, they've already pursued their transactions, audits, settlements, tax penalties. But taxing authorities also engage in actions that occur ex ante, before the transactions ever happen. They issue advanced tax rulings, like the type that are at the center of all of the controversy in Europe right now, or enter into advanced tax agreements. My claim in this project is that ex ante tax administration should be publicly disclosed as a means of accountability, but ex post tax enforcement information should remain private in order to preserve the taxing authority's ability to apply the tax law and enforce it. So why should ex post tax enforcement information remain private? Imagine that we could see everything. Complete tax return information was publicly accessible. This has been suggested by some commentators at various times in the United States. Portions of our tax return information were public. As I've argued elsewhere, this type of broad public disclosure poses several threats to effective tax enforcement. First, if we could see all tax return information, we would observe not only examples where the taxing authority catches tax cheats. This often happens in April every year in the United States. Flowers bloom and baby animals are born and tax evaders go to prison every April, right before April 15th, our tax day. So we would see that, but we would also see vivid examples of the taxing authority letting tax cheats get away. And these salient examples could diminish taxpayers' perceptions of the government's strengths in detecting tax offenses. Further, public disclosure of complete tax return information could increase the ability of certain actors, such as shareholders, including investment funds, to compare the tax positions of different taxpayers and establish what I've described as benchmarks of aggressiveness in certain tax compliance areas, and then pressure their agents to keep pace with the tax planning of others. And last, disclosure of certain tax return information could enhance the ability of advisors and other third parties to reverse engineer the taxing authority's detection strategies. There's a much more compelling case, I argue, for mandatory public disclosure of ex-ante tax administration, like advanced tax rulings. First, non-disclosure of advanced tax rulings threatens the sociological legitimacy, the perceived legitimacy of the taxing authority. Without disclosure, the public may suspect that the taxing authority creates secret tax law or it doesn't apply equal treatment to taxpayers when it issues these rulings. Second, public disclosure of advanced tax rulings can promote efficient financial transactions by providing taxpayers with greater understanding of the taxing authority's interpretation of the law. And finally, public disclosure of advanced tax rulings does not threaten the taxing authority's ability to enforce the tax law for a number of reasons that I don't have time to discuss right now, but would be happy to. So what type of ex-ante tax administration should be publicly accessible? In this paper, I argue that we should adopt a new standard of openness in tax transparency that I've described as dual tax transparency, And the basic idea is this. In addition to being required to release the determinations where the taxing authority grants taxpayers advance ruling requests, I argue that it should also be required to disclose instances where it denies taxpayers ruling requests. So just to describe why I present that argument, imagine you're trying to conduct a study. You want to find out how you could gain admission to NYU Law School, and you want to take a look at the personal statements that students submit when they apply. So if you only looked at the personal statements of the people who were accepted to NYU Law School and then tried to draw conclusions, that would be a pretty questionable study. To do this correctly, you would want to take a look at everything, the students who were admitted and the students who were denied. Likewise, if we only observe advance rulings where the taxing authority said yes, we'll gain a limited, potentially very distorted understanding of the taxing authority's interpretation of the tax law. Now, I know, as some people in the room know, in the United States, under Section 6110 of the Internal Revenue Code, the IRS must publicly disclose all written determinations in response to any requests by taxpayers. But, as I'll show in just a couple of minutes, current law prevents dual tax transparency of ex-ante tax administration in several areas. So I'll just give you a few quick examples and then we'll conclude. Withdrawn private letter rulings. So in the overwhelming majority of private letter ruling requests, the IRS says yes and grants the ruling request. Why so few adverse private letter ruling requests? I remember this from practice. There's like a manual the IRS produces to tell people how to request ruling requests. And there's this statement that you can see I've bolded. When you go for your ruling request, the branch representative at the IRS will orally notify you of its conclusions in advance. And if the IRS is going to say no, rule adversely, the taxpayer will get an opportunity to withdraw the ruling request. You can just say, I don't want to have that ruling request considered at all. So virtually all taxpayers who learn that they're going to receive an adverse ruling, again through the special oral notification, withdraw, and their ruling requests just disappear. And one other thing I remembered from practice is that when a taxpayer withdraws a private letter ruling request, it's possible that the IRS may write a special memo. And this memo describes the fact that there was a ruling request which was withdrawn, and it goes to certain offices where the taxpayer is located. And when this happens, it's possible that this memo itself will become public. It's called chief counsel advice. So when I learned about this, I said, well, I would like to go take a look at all of these withdrawals that were described in the memos, because that would be interesting in terms of getting the two sides of the story. And I took a look at several years of data, and just to give you some of it, I'll give you an example. 2002 to 2006, on average, 1,652 private letter ruling requests were submitted to the IRS. And the IRS issued 1,332. So 320 private letter ruling requests were withdrawn. So at this point, I wanted to review the memos to describe why they were withdrawn. And I found on average 2.2 private letter ruling withdrawal memos that were written each year. In other words, in 99.31% of the cases where private letter rulings were withdrawn, you couldn't read about it at all. There were just no memos. One of the reasons there were no memos is that as long as the taxpayer represents, I'm abandoning the transaction or I will abandon it, the IRS won't produce the memo. So dual tax transparency here is just absent. As an alternative, in the US, if every private letter ruling request and any written determination and withdrawal were open to public inspection, we could achieve dual tax transparency. Another quick example, adverse tax exempt determination letters. There's been no issue more controversial in the United States than tax-exempt organizations seeking approval from the IRS to have their status, specifically Section 501(c)(4) status. The IRS, as some in the room may know, today is engaged in day 1,233 of what I will describe as a controversy involving whether, and tax people can tell you how I calculated that number, whether the IRS took a look at the requests and filtered out the ones that had words like Tea Party or Patriot in the title. And current law requires public disclosure where an organization gets a positive ruling from the IRS that they can be tax exempt, and the organization has to make it public, so does the IRS. But if the IRS says no, an adverse determination letter, it publicly releases the letter, but it strips out the name of the taxpayer. So without the identities of the different organizations, the ones that get the positive letter and the ones that get the negative letter, we can't determine whether the IRS applies different treatment depending on political, religious, or any other characteristics. Public trust in the IRS, I argue, would be enhanced if it were required to publicly disclose all tax-exempt applications and ultimate determinations, favorable and adverse, without deleting identifying information. Last, advanced pricing agreements, which we've already talked about at this conference. As we know, this is almost a form of permission from the taxing authority for the largest U.S. multinational corporations to structure their global affairs in ways that will avoid billions of dollars in potential future tax liability. In the United States, there is no tax transparency, let alone dual tax transparency, regarding advanced pricing agreements. These are explicitly described as confidential return information in the tax privacy statute. The lack of public disclosure of advanced pricing agreements, what some have called special deals, has generated suspicion that the IRS has facilitated U.S. and global tax avoidance by U.S. multinational corporations. Public disclosure of both the request for advanced pricing agreements and any final agreement would preserve the sociological legitimacy of the IRS and encourage efficient transactions. With that, I'm out of time, so thank you very much.
Well, thanks to Nikki and to Philip and all the others who've organized this conference. I agree with others. It's a great idea to link these different perspectives between tax law and human rights law. So the main kind of international policy response to a lot of the developments we've been discussing is cross-border tax information exchange. And my draft paper tries to help us think about how can governments do a better job at sharing tax and non-tax information across borders to help them enforce their laws against offshore tax evasion, against aggressive international tax planning, also international money laundering and cross-border terrorist financing, as that latter one's becoming an increasingly important policy issue. And so I'll touch on some of the information and incentive problems that serve to as a barrier to effective reform. I'll discuss different elements of optimal transfers, and then very briefly touch on the potential role of data analytics to help governments conduct their tax audits. In terms of some context, I think our opening speaker, Winnie, in particular, did a good job. I'll just mention the last couple of bullet points. Some of you may have read at least the media attention surrounding the Sentry report last week concerning South Sudan, the world's newest country. They have an ongoing civil war, and the investigative journalists revealed that out of the 10 million citizens, 5 million are currently on food aid at near famine levels. While this is happening, the corrupt elites are robbing the country blind and pushing all their money offshore into tax havens. And so, in theory at least, global financial transparency initiatives would help reduce that. And I was thinking of this Clooney effect to George Clooney's credit. He's the co-founder of this Sentry or journalist organization. And I thought, is there any way to link the themes of this conference to the breakup of Brangelina? Because of course, then everybody on the planet would know absolutely everything about this particular topic. My own recent paper, Big Data and Tax Haven Secrecy, relies on my consulting work for the International Consortium for Investigative Journalists. A year prior to the first public revelation in 2013, they hired myself and a team of researchers to explain to the journalists this incredible gobbledygook, financial gobbledygook that they were looking at. And so in the paper, I trace some of these developments, to a lesser extent, more recent Panama papers, but again, the more LuxLeaks and this earlier leak. And a couple of capital flight revelations that we uncovered. There's the Sergei Magnitsky affair. It's a kind of a complicated matter, but basically a Moscow tax attorney revealed government corruption. He was in prison, allegedly tortured and murdered by the Russian government. They have always maintained their innocence, rather, but the data leak revealed that one of the implicated tax officials, she gave roughly $20 million to her husband. He put it into an offshore service provider that was owned by a Canadian. There was another web of 30 companies that were created. And ultimately, some of those monies were invested in Manhattan condos not far from here. And so it served as evidence of government corruption and so on. We looked at over 22,000 accounts maintained by Chinese individuals for offshore investment purposes as well. So in terms of some of the information and incentive problems, you know, the main problem, of course, is that tax authorities currently know very little about their taxpayers' global income beyond taxpayer self-disclosure, and that usually ends the story. They really know nothing, and so these cross-border tax information exchange initiatives are trying to address that. But you know, it is an uphill battle given the existing political incentives of low-income, middle-income countries, at least illiberal or non-democratic regimes, and Ruben mentioned this in his talk, tend to engage the individuals or a certain small percentage of corrupt elites within those countries tends to want to push their money offshore as exit strategies, so they like the status quo. Of course, tax havens, Luxembourg, Switzerland, the Bahamas, Barbados, they have economic interest in maintaining the status quo. But also wealthy countries. I mentioned the Magnitsky capital flight affair where the monies ultimately get invested in the United States. So the US and other governments maintain financial secrecy laws that mask the identity of beneficial owners. And it's hard for us to overcome these political hurdles. I think also, you know, Miranda began her talk by saying, well, who could oppose transparency? Well, the multinational firm community tends to oppose these things, and they spend a lot of money lobbying governments to tamp down or outright destroy EOI initiatives. Why don't they like it? I mean, I think it's more obvious with respect to criminals. They like the status quo. How about legitimate taxpayers? Accounting academics have looked at this issue over the last several decades, dozens of empirical studies. There are essentially four reasons why legit taxpayers don't want these EOI initiatives. Number one, it heightens the risk of tax audit, so we shouldn't care about that. We should engage in the reforms. Number two, there's evidence that managers suboptimally transfer their resources around the globe, and they don't want their shareholders to find out about it. So this is an agency problem, and again, we should encourage the reforms. The last two issues, I think, are a little trickier. Sometimes multinationals argue that if they transfer their information to a foreign government, this will reveal a commercial confidence or a trade secret. There are protections both within tax treaties and new country-by-country reporting initiatives to deal with that, but that's their concern. I think they don't voice this as much, but another concern is that these financial disclosures will reveal profit margins, for instance. So less sensitive forms of financial information, they're not protected under treaties, but you know, if there's a global supply chain that a particular multinational has structured, they don't necessarily want their competitors to find out about it. So these are firm competitiveness concerns. In response, sometimes legal writers say, well, those last two concerns are overblown. Cite me some examples. And the problem is, in the last few years, because of other leaks, we actually have examples of that, such as WikiLeaks, which revealed that the NSA and its Canadian counterpart, CSIS, conduct cross-border corporate espionage. So our virtuous spies in Canada were revealed to be spying on the Brazilian mining ministry, as one example. And they do this, and China, there's a lot of evidence they're engaged in this as well, to bolster their domestic industries and potentially undermine foreign competitors. And so these multinational firm concerns, unfortunately, have been given greater credence in the last couple of years. Now, on to thinking about how can we improve the system? Well, you know, there's a number of challenges. We're moving from, there's horrible acronyms up there, FATCA, CRS, and CBCR, moving from bulk exchanges to focusing on high-quality exchanges. And if I look to the tax compliance literature, thinking about supporting tax authorities' efforts through third-party reporting, withholding taxes, and so on, increasingly tax authorities have high net worth audit groups, which makes sense. So this is useful information that they can transfer across borders, and verifiable information means that the tax authority can ascertain the info or the data was not tampered. And for instance, the IRS website alone gets 1 million hack attempts per week against that, and a lot of this is bots and things like that. key concern. Others have talked about taxpayer privacy rights, but because of the misaligned incentives that I mentioned, it's difficult to see real traction in this area. And I would also agree with Stephen and Ruben's comment that until we come up with this withholding tax, there'll always be leakage within the system, and it simply won't work. The system is too porous, some people have suggested. Data analytics is kind of a newish thing in the last, say, half decade in the tax world. Starting with big data, these are large data sets. They're varied. There's usually an ongoing flow, unlike the static data sets obtained by the ICIJ. And increasingly, tax authorities that at least have the administrative capacity to do so are subjecting these large data sets to data analytics. And so that's simply the computer analysis of the data sets to reveal relationships or matters that had previously been obscured. A couple of examples in this area. The New York Department of Taxation and Finance has been engaged in the last few years in data analytics. When you file for a tax refund request in this state, they cross-index that request against literally billions of public records, as well as some commercial records. And it's led, for instance, to a tax revenue bump in 2010 of $1.2 billion for this state. I'll also mention the Australian Taxation Office, very aggressive in this space, and they have an innovative program that, for instance, looks at a taxpayer's self-disclosure of offshore income and assets, and they cross-index that against insurance disclosures. So that's kind of neat. It would be illegal because of our privacy laws in Canada to do such a thing. But in any event, it's quite innovative, and we're jealous. And the final idea is to consider deputizing members of the private sector to go after this phenomena of aggressive international tax avoidance. In particular, the transfer pricing, where the taxpayers typically outgun authorities. There is some academic commentary. People like Joe Bankman find the whole idea unseemly because government would be abdicating its role. So time's up. In conclusion, I think we've kind of seen a sea change in cross-border tax information exchange. The progress is laudable. I sometimes characterize the international tax regime as glacially paced. It hasn't really changed in 100 years. And yet in the last decade, we've seen all these new reforms. The focus has to move from bulk to high quality information exchanges. But as long as we have these incentive problems, it may be difficult to gain any real success.
Thank you very much to Nikki and Philip for this wonderful conference. My paper examines how certain human rights tools might be used to encourage the U.S. to more fully participate in the financial transparency agenda. The Boston Consulting Group calculates that roughly 25% of private wealth in the Middle East and Africa, as well as Latin America, is booked offshore, totaling approximately $3.1 trillion. This offshore investment, of course, contributes to the tax gap in developing countries because it allows the wealthy individuals and companies to evade taxes on the monies held offshore. And we've talked at great length at this conference about the fact that the resulting revenue losses negatively affect the abilities of the respective countries to meet their human rights commitments. Well, tax administrations have a responsibility to tackle these serious taxpayer compliance problems in the interest of fairness. And I posit that obstructing those tax administrations from remedying their tax evasion problem is a violation of the United States' international human rights obligations. So it's very troubling that we see that as other governments improve their financial transparency, the share of offshore wealth destined for the United States is increasing. Now, automatic exchange of information among tax administrations is one of the ways to fight offshore tax evasion. And so jurisdictions globally are being encouraged to implement the Common Reporting Standard CRS that was developed by the OECD. And the hope is that these international standards should ensure effective exchanges of tax information and should aid tax authorities in combating tax evasion. Over 100 jurisdictions have committed to implementing CRS in either 2017 or 2018, but the United States is not one of those countries. The United States is falling behind its peers with respect to financial transparency due to our complete legislative and regulatory inaction. We have pledged reciprocal information sharing in our FATCA intergovernmental agreements with more than 50 jurisdictions. We have more IGAs, but not all of them make a promise that we're not keeping. Even with respect to those 50 jurisdictions where we have promised reciprocity, we're legally only able to share a very small piece of information, and that is the amount of interest that is paid to these foreign recipients. And we only share that right now with 37 specified countries that have been specified by the US government as being allowed to receive this automatic exchange of information. This is in lieu of the detailed information that we expect under FATCA to receive from the more than 200,000 financial institutions that have registered with the Internal Revenue Service. So FATCA, for example, requires foreign financial institutions to ascertain the substantial U.S. owners of certain legal entities, while the U.S. banks only have to report on the individual accounts of foreign residents. So the information exchange rules for banks in the United States with respect to foreign residents are extremely easy to avoid. All you have to do is hold the bank account in the name of a shell corporation. So my paper discusses the legislative and regulatory changes that are needed, such as the collection of beneficial ownership information for any legal entities formed in the United States. The Global Forum, which monitors the OECD work being done on tax transparency and the exchange of information, only found the United States to be largely compliant. That's not as good as compliant. Concerning ownership information for entities during its peer review of the US tax system. And while I was in Luxembourg on a Fulbright and met with finance ministry staff at both the Luxembourg Ministry of Finance and the Austrian Ministry of Finance, I heard repeated complaints. I kept telling them I'm not a representative of the US government, I'm an academic, but they took the opportunity to complain bitterly about the lack of beneficial ownership information in several states, Wyoming, Delaware, Nevada, et cetera. These omissions have been heavily criticized by the international community and have led to the US being labeled a tax haven. And I'm going to use a quote from our luncheon speaker's book, The Hidden Wealth of Nations. This is a real problem because tax havens are at the heart of financial, budgetary, and democratic crises. The OECD noted in its 20 report last April that jurisdictions that seek to profit from a lack of transparency can no longer be tolerated. And the US will be subject to a second round of peer review by the Global Forum, which will also assess the strengthened standard that they're going to be looking at on the availability of beneficial ownership. This may incentivize the United States to take the required legislative action, but given the current political climate, may yield nothing more than a weak compromise. So I'm recommending that more efforts should be made to include financial transparency in the human rights agenda in order to increase the pressure on the US. So for example, the United Nations has something called the Universal Periodic Review. It is a unique process that reviews the status of each state's human rights obligations and commitments. The reviews consist of a national report that is submitted by the state itself, a summary that is prepared by the Office of the High Commissioner of Stakeholders Submissions, And then there's a compilation of various other reports. The U.S. submitted its last national report in 2015. Unfortunately, surprise, surprise, there was no discussion of any issues regarding financial transparency. However, in the stakeholders report, there was an urging of the United States to fully implement the UN guiding principles on business and human rights. These guiding principles implement the UN's protect, respect, and remedy framework that deals with human rights and business enterprises. The guiding principles set forth three principles, and I'm going to deal with the first, and that is the state's duty to protect human rights. The guiding principles are grounded in recognition of the state's existing obligations to respect, protect, and fulfill human rights. This duty requires that the state protect against human rights abuses by third parties, including businesses. This means that the state must take, and I quote, appropriate steps to prevent, punish, and redress such abuses through effective policies, legislation, and regulations. Furthermore, a state must promote the rule of law, ensure the fairness of its application, as well as provide for procedural and legal transparency. I posit that enabling offshore tax evasion is a violation of human rights. Therefore, the United States must enact whatever legislation is necessary to ensure the appropriate exchange of information with treaty partners to aid them in their respective wars on tax evasion. And this duty to protect human rights also requires passage of effective beneficial ownership legislation. The Panama Papers have demonstrated that the use of anonymous shell corporations is facilitating tax evasion. The commentary to the guiding principles notes that a state might breach its international human rights obligations where such abuses can be attributed to it. I posit that the intentional attraction of foreign money to U.S. banks by having restrictive information exchange policies is such an abuse. The commentary goes on to note that it may also be a violation of human rights obligations when the state fails to take any action to prevent a private actor's abuse. The United States is fully aware that inappropriate corporations are being formed in states like Nevada, Wyoming, and Delaware, and has not passed any legislation to require that beneficial ownership information that would stop this practice. Now, given the political nature of this situation, naming and shaming needs to be ramped up in order to require the desired result. The OECD, in its latest economic survey of the United States, called for adoption of CRS by 2017 or 2018. The Tax Justice Network has put the United States in third place on its financial secrecy index because of its unwillingness to participate in transparency initiatives such as CRS and the creation of public registers of beneficial ownership. In conclusion, our U.S. Secretary of Treasury, Liu, has admitted in his letter to Congress that gaps remain in our laws that allow bad actors to deliberately use U.S. companies to hide money laundering, tax evasion, and other illicit financial activities. These failures to prevent tax abuses by private actors can be considered a breach of the United States' international human rights obligations, and I call upon civil society to continue their work such as what the GFI has done, demanding financial transparency legislation from the United States. And I hope that more human rights organizations will get involved in bringing tax evasion to the forefront of their human rights discussions and universal periodic review reports. Thank you very much.
First of all, I would like to thank the center for organizing this conference and having me on this panel. And I think sometimes as scholars, we realize we're sort of dwarves on the shoulders of giants. And right now, I sort of feel more like sitting amidst my footnotes. So it's a much more comforting situation. It doesn't give a vertigo, at least. So I'm really grateful for that. And I'll just like to move to, let's say, the fundamental research question of my paper. And you could really say transparency. What is transparency? And I could reply, if you don't ask me, I know. If you ask me, then I don't know. And basically, I took a long step back in this regard, and somewhat leaving the policy and legal domain, and the most, illuminating definition of transparency I could come across, it's laid back to a few centuries ago, and I found it in a treatise on the soul by Aristotle, where he defines transparency as basically a property of beings by virtue of which those beings are visible, though not visible in themselves, but owing their visibility to the color of another thing. And I think this is very telling in the sense that that's why it's so difficult to define transparency, because you cannot really define it in isolation. It doesn't exist in a void. And that's something that I think displays a meaningful parallel with human rights, because I was taught, my first course on human rights law, that human rights, by definition, are indivisible and interdependent. And that's why, of course, there are many different definitions of transparency, but everything is held together. So just, for the sake of time, and also I would like to concentrate on a specific dimension of transparency in my talk. But in order to do that, I would like to provide a sort of taxonomy of the possible forms of transparency we can come across. And that is very easily done by answering, the fundamental questions of journalists, so the who, the what, the why, and so forth. And or in legal terms, you could say by distinguishing between the subjective scope of application of a transparency obligation and the objective scope. Coming to the objective scope of application, I would say that there are at least three forms of possible transparency obligation. So the most obvious one, and one that comes to mind when is probably so-called documentary transparency, so making documents available. But there is more to that, especially in the domain of transparency obligations by public administration. So indeed, we can think of a decision-making transparency, which is, I would say, directly linked to legitimacy issues. And beside that, a procedural or operational transparency, so how things are conducted, basically. At the same time, of course, there is a subjective dimension to transparency, so which has two levels. So for whom transparency is carried out and by whom should transparency be exercised. In my talk, I would like to focus on the transparency obligations of administrations, because I think this dimension has been somewhat underplayed in the very recent debate in Atlassian International Tax. When you look at other areas of international economic law, international governance, transparency really means mostly the transparency of standard setters, of governments, and so forth. And in tax, as a last decade or so, we are all focusing on what you could define as a sort of extractive understanding of transparency, where basically it's all about extracting information from taxpayers, which is something very useful and necessary, but does not exhaust the topic of transparency. Or at least it would if the other side of the coin had been taken care of. And based on my, brief review of the status quo, I can say that this is not the case. The thing is that when you think about transparency, well, you may come up with a sort of probably a slightly superficial statement in that transparency per se is a human right, but that's not completely accurate in the sense that you can find many different claims to transparency. And so you have to sort of really try to decompose transparency obligation and link it to possible existing rights. And that's what I tried to do by browsing through different bodies of case law, mostly in the area of international economic law, scholarship, and so forth. And I came to the conclusion that transparency is basically linked to what I call the big three, basically, at least in this administrative dimension. And the first right or prerogative that is linked to transparency is probably what can be defined as the duty for public administration to give reasons. That's actually the kind of duty with the largest body of case law supporting it, and sometimes it hides in very unlikely places. For instance, a lot of exit arbitral awards based on the NAFTA agreements, that's hardly a place where we would look probably for human rights, but it's very interesting because it's one of the few areas where this duty for administrations to give reason of their conduct has been, let's say, sanctioned on the basis of a transparency requirement. It's one of the few, let's say, instances of international case law where transparency is called by that name. The second factor is, or the second dimension, is participation of the regulated subject, so to say, to the administrative action of the regulators. And there are different degrees to that. You can think about the most basic form, which is probably notification, and you can think of more, let's say, advanced complex forms, such as, for instance, participation rights. And that's actually an area that is very relevant for tax, because I think that paradoxically, as an effect of the transparency crusade meant as, let's say, extracting information from taxpayers, which has also led to the formulation of international standards in this area, the minimum standard of participation rights has decreased. So based on a recent report by International Fiscal Association, you can see clearly that those countries that, for instance, used to grant notification rights to taxpayers affected by information exchange had to cease to do so because basically the OECD determined that it was not really in line with the best practices or like with the terms of reference. The third dimension that is relevant is probably in this sense, of course, the most obvious one, access to documents, which can be seen on many different levels. First of all, I mean, access to files. So if you're party to an administrative proceeding, you have the right to access the documentation that concerns your position, or otherwise in broader terms, and of course the Freedom of Information Act and the whole legacy of the tax analyst case concerning the public availability of private letter rulings come to mind. So also in this case, we have varying degrees of practice. We could see there are like extremes on both sides. And to my surprise, in a way, I realized that there is very little homogeneity at the comparative level when it comes to these three fundamental amenable dimension of transparency. Every country, let's say, has different rules, different sensitivities, and it's quite sad to reckon that especially, I mean, this applies to the global north, so to say, but also especially in the global south, this kind of minimal guarantees are typically not really granted. So once again, I would like to reconnect to the Latin broker that was raised yesterday, ubi ius ibi remedium. And in this case, it's let's say, twofold, because the problem is that not only there is no remedy in the cross-border setting, but sometimes there is no proper remedy for enjoying these transparency prerogatives, even in the domestic one. I would say that in the cross-border setting, there is an interesting, what you could define as a reverse regulatory arbitrage. I mean, of course, we are all familiar with cross-border tax arbitrage. So basically, you end up not paying taxes anywhere because you take advantage of the differences. But the same happens with procedural rules. So if you are in the context of a cross-border administrative proceeding, for instance, being notified about a measure of information or tax information exchange, then maybe those rights that are granted in the domestic sphere simply liquefy in the cross-border situation because you don't really know which administration is responsible for ensuring those. And I think this should lead us to think further on this dimension of transparency. Both, I would say, at the international level, but also at the domestic level. Of course, we may argue, well, this is something linked to legal cultures and different sensitivities. But I beg to differ in the sense that, and this is where, I guess, the the influence of human rights law can be more evident. Well, one of the attributes of human rights law is that, by definition, international human rights law is inward targeted, so it turns states inside out and exposes them to international scrutiny. Tax, international tax, works differently. Typically, tax treaties are, some define them as border rules, or in any case, they don't really look through domestic systems. But things are changing also in tax. In the aftermath of BEPS, we definitely have an inward targeted dimension to tax. We have, peer review and global standards and so forth. But most of these standards have so far been concerned with substantive issues, substantive measures, and there is a lack of standards in this administrative dimension of tax. So just to quote a famous adagio right now, international tax, international law. Of course, I think that's something everyone reckons nowadays, but what about international tax as global administrative law? And I think there's a possibly fascinating research agenda to be written in that regard. So I hope this conference will, in a way, promote and bring this to the fore. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alessandro, both for the content and for sticking to time, and likewise to all of our panelists. Unfortunately, we are caught between the push of a broad and fascinating panel and the pull of an equally, or if not more, fascinating lunchtime speaker, and for that matter, lunch itself. So despite the richness of the presentations, I think we've got time just for perhaps two or three questions and then a quick final comment from a handful of the panelists. So just to if three people can come up to the mics, and we'll have to call it there. Please.
Yeah, I'd like to sort of follow up on Tracy's comments, and I guess this is addressed primarily to Miranda, but it really relates to the conference as a whole. There's been a good deal of discussion of individual evasion and money laundering, where it turns out, as Tracy has reminded us, that the United States has not acquitted itself well. It's not through lethargy, it's through the active positions taken by members of Congress, particularly from Florida, whose interests lie with the banks in that state. And then we've talked a great deal about multinational firms, and that's why I think this relates to Miranda, and their behavior. And I'd like to just submit to those people who think about tax justice that, again, the United States of America not only doesn't acquit itself well, but can be seen as an active enabler of multinational avoidance. From press reports, we see that the most important deliverable from BEPS was country-by-country reporting, which is a fundamental transparency issue. And from press reports, CBC reporting was substantially diluted by the U.S. Treasury Department. And then the smoking gun that we haven't talked very much about, the recent white paper published by Treasury in respect of Apple, which can be read by an outsider as saying simply this, that the United States actively encourages foreign-to-foreign stateless income gaming by U.S. multinationals, not merely acknowledges it, but actively encourages it, on the premise that one day that money that was not taxed in the appropriate state will be taxed in the United States. It is not possible to imagine a tax system that works for multinational firms when the largest, most important single economy in the world actively is working to undercut the fundamental premise of arm's length pricing. And I do hope that, I think to some extent that Miranda's comments and mine are a little bit of cross purposes, but I do hope that that theme is one that people might think worth following up on.
A quick question, please.
So Arthur's suggestion about global financial registry reminds me of my ongoing question about this automatic exchange of information and tax transparency. I think the current movement toward automatic exchange of information is successful because although the discourse is going on multilaterally, the implementation mechanism is essentially bilateral. But when we are more successful on the automatic exchange of information and we build history, then we might need someone or some institution or some country who take control of this whole, you know, system. And in that case, who or which government or which institution, international institution, is the legitimate, would have a legitimate authority to monitor this whole system? And also, we may really need to equip with the Global Financial Registry in the future. Then who would be responsible for that, you know, information? I am a huge supporter of tax transparency, global tax transparency, but even I would be hesitant if I think that my information would go to the Global Financial Registry, not to the governments that I'm connected with. So that's my question.
And one last question.
My name is Anita Gutu from the University of South Africa, and my question would be to Arthur or anybody else that can answer. In the era of WikiLeaks, Panama files, and the Bahama files we have now, and the role that these files have played to expose tax abuses and, of course, the human rights issues that arise from there, what can be done to legitimize this kind of exposures that we have? Because as we stand right now, many countries can't proceed because they see the way they were exposed was not really legally. So what can be done to ensure that these kinds of things that are actually rising and are going to be the norm in times to come, exposing these types of things, that they're actually legitimized in advancing the exposures of?
Yeah, I think that's a particularly interesting question in terms of, you know, it's the flip side of protecting the whistleblower, it's protecting the whistleblown information. Mm-hmm. Who wants to tackle a couple of these key questions?
Okay, with respect to the question concerning automatic information exchange, we actually have a fair amount of experience. So with these regimes, Canada and the United States have had one in place since 1996, at least with respect to cross-border portfolio interest income. There's been scholarly efforts to assess it. They've kind of been uneven. Alison Christians has been part of these efforts, and we've done freedom of information requests because of taxpayer privacy concerns. Haven't had too much information coming back. In terms of the Global Financial Registry, I think we'll hear from our luncheon speaker more about that. But to me, at least, I mean, these are really valid concerns, taxpayer privacy concerns. The information should never be public, which, you know, some people advocate that the information should be available to the public and they could access it and look at it like the data leaks. But to me, I think it should just be among the government. I don't think that would be feasible in any event in terms of a policy proposal. So there's a lot of concern surrounding the illegal access of this very sensitive form of personal information.
I've just got one specific response on the who would be responsible question. I haven't seen anything written about this, but the Multilateral Convention on Tax Administration Mutual Assistance has a provision in it to establish a governing body that will interpret the convention. It doesn't say that that body is the OECD, and it's actually not even clear to me if we set up that body. Maybe someone can enlighten us. But I think that there is potential there to establish an administering body that is established under the convention itself. So it has a separated role from the existing institutions that we already have out there. Just very briefly on the multinational thing, I'm not quite sure if we're on the same page. Ed, I agree the U.S. is extremely annoying in many ways. However, I'd be in... I think that there is scope for other countries to proceed, nonetheless. And the way forward, it seems to me, for other countries is actually to do a combination of the public disclosure stick, country by country, on multinational corporations, and to build those corporations into their regulatory nets. And this is what we did historically in the last century domestically, closed economies. Corporations are a key part of the tax system, of collecting taxes nationally. And we see this in VAT, right? So we see what it looks like voluntary compliance by the big multinational corporates. But it's because they are being embedded in the regulatory networks. So it seems to me that's the way countries can move forward.
Any other last comments? Or no? In that case, I'd like to, again, thank the panelists and encourage everybody to grab a quick bite of lunch and then bring it back for the lunchtime speech. Thank you very much.